So, this top name of the topic is dynamics of disease transmission. The diagram what is shown here is A for source of reservoir, B for mode of transmission of disease, and C for susceptible person. The aim of this teaching this topic is how the disease agent, means the infectious agent, enters from the source of the reservoir into the body of the susceptible person. In last 2-3 lectures, I have discussed the source and the reservoir. Yesterday, I started with the modes of transmission of disease. Means modes of transmission of disease means what are the different ways, what are the different routes by which the disease agent can enter into the body of the susceptible person. So, by and large, for study purpose, this disease agent enters into the body of the host by a direct, without any intermediate thing, direct transmission of disease. Example is common cold. If one person is suffering from the common cold, because of the infection of the common cold virus, what we call in medical terminology as a paraiza, the another person who comes in contact, close contact with the infected person, will get that disease. So this is called a direct mode of transmission. Few diseases are transmitted by single mode of transmission. That is a fecal oral route. Example is typhoid infection. There is one more mode of transmission called as multiple mode of transmission. Means in this there are many modes, 1, 2, 3 modes by which, or a ways or a route by which the disease agent enters from the source of reservoir into the body of the susceptible host. Susceptible host means here the human being, man or a female. So by and large, direct mode of transmission, single mode of transmission, and third is the multiple modes of transmission by which the disease agent can enter. So in last lecture, I started with the classification of mode of transmission of disease. See, if you are bored in reading the book, you can follow my YouTube channel, Shivraj Mathwati. You type in the Google or a Chrome, you can find all these lectures. If somebody is following or not, I don't know. Better you go through that. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, at the most 20 minutes. If you don't have the book, you can also read from the YouTube channel. Now coming to the, yesterday I started with the classification of the modes of transmission. There are two this mode of transmission is classified under two headings: direct mode of transmission and indirect mode of transmission. In direct mode of transmission, yesterday I discussed the formula called as G2. Direct infection, then the droplet infection, then the contact with the soil, inoculation into skin and mucosa, and torch agent. This I have discussed yesterday. Today I will discuss the indirect mode of transmission. Again, there are five things. Here are again five things. Number two. Vehicle-borne, vector-borne, air-borne, fomite-borne, and infection through the unclean hands and fingers. So again, so the formula given for this is UVAF. So you can remember these things. Means vector borne, vehicle borne, air borne, fomite borne, and the infection through the unclean hands and fingers. Very simple. Today I will discuss only these two: vehicle borne and the vector borne. Basic thing about the indirect mode of transmission is some intermediate agency, maybe the living agent or a non-living agent, is required for transmission of the disease from the source of reservoir into the body of the susceptible person. That's why it is called as indirect. Yesterday I discussed the direct mode of transmission. So first is the vehicle wall. So this is the agency which is required for the transmission of the disease from reservoir source into the body of the susceptible person. Vehicle. So vehicle may be the intermediate agent thing, may be water, food, blood, then the water, food, blood, urine, watering from the eyes, from the lacrimal gland, semen, CSF, any liquid thing. They act as a vehicle for transmission of the disease. Sometimes this infectious agent may get multiplication or a replication into the vehicle and may be and able to cause the disease. So what is required here is water, food, blood, even organs, body organs, they can act as a vehicle, intermediate agency, what we call as dalal, for transmission of the disease. So if you discuss, as I told you, water, food, blood, organ, and other body fluids also, so these are the things which are required for the transmission, vehicle-borne transmission of the disease. Now, vehicle may be the, so these are the vehicles by which infectious agent can get transmitted into the body of the susceptible host. So water, how this water is able to work? If water is polluted water with the cholera bacillus, suppose, then the cholera infectious agent, then if that water is consumed without chlorination, then it will cause the GI tract infection. So what are the diseases caused by consumption of the infected water? It may cause diarrhea, dysentery, dehydration, and typhoid, that is enteric fever, shigellosis, all these diseases, typhoid, paratyphoid, all, even a hepatitis A infection, which is a waterborne disease, can be transmitted because of the consumption of infected water. Next is the food. If the food is infected with the infectious agent and that food is consumed by the person, again the diseases can be transmitted, caused because of the consumption of this infected food. Again, all GI tract diseases, diarrhea, vomiting, dysentery, typhoid, etc., gastroenteritis. Now coming to the blood. Blood is the strong vehicle by which we can, this is one of the strongest vehicle apart from the food and the water, through which the infection agent can get transmitted to the human being. So disease is transmitted by the blood, called as blood-borne infection. In this, number one is hepatitis B, HIV infection. Even the infected malaria person, if his blood is transmitted to the other, malaria can be transmitted to the normal person. Next is the organs. If the person is suffering from some diseases called as some diseases of heart and the kidney, and if that person needs the heart transplantation or the kidney transplantation, then the cytomegalovirus can be transmitted from his organ to the normal person. If the infected organ is transplanted into the normal person, the person may get the infection called as cytomegalovirus. So this is all about the basic thing about the vehicle-borne disease. Now what are the characteristics of vehicle borne diseases. The characteristic of vehicle borne diseases, number one is, if the dose of the vehicle, for example, infected water or infected food, if the dose of the vehicle, infected food or water or blood, is high, much more, if it contains the much more infectious material, if the dose is high, then the outcome of the disease will be too much. For example, infected water or food is consumed by a person, infection with the cholera, the outbreak of the cholera will be more, number one. Number two, if the vehicle is withdrawn, or if the vehicle is controlled, then the outbreak can be brought under control. Means if the infected water or the infected food is taken out, or some purification methods are done on the water or the food material, the outcome will stop. But if the strong dose is there, strong outcome will be there. If the vehicle is withdrawn, this epidemic of cholera can be stopped. Number three, once this cholera patient, or suppose that food is consumed, it may cause a food poisoning. If you withdraw the food, food which is infected with the poison, then the food poisoning can come under control. Number three, if the primary case means the first case of cholera or food poisoning there, if it infect the other secondary case, that is the primary case to secondary case, if you infect the other case, it becomes the secondary case. If the many times you cannot find out the primary case, but you can find the secondary case. So if you, in medical terminology, this is called as, if the secondary case is seen, primary case may be obscured, means may not be seen. So these are the few characteristics of the vehicle-borne disease. Now coming to the vector-borne disease. Here vector means arthropod. Arthropod means innerwear. Arthropod means insect, fly, or a snail. So here the vector-borne disease, the specific thing about vector-borne disease is, infectious agent enters into the body of the host. Means the infection of malaria enters into the body of the mosquito. In the mosquito, it may get replicated, means it may increase in number, or there may occur the cyclical changes from one stage to another stage of that malaria bacilli, say malaria infection. So specific thing about this vector is, once this infectious agent is exited or given away from the body of the this arthropod, it must maintain its virulence, that is the pathogenicity, and once it gets the favorable conditions, atmospheric favorable condition, it may have the power to infect the other normal person. So this basic thing is required for vector. Now coming to what, there are three things about the vector. Remember, vector means arthropod borne disease. Arthropod means insect, snail, fly, or mosquito. So don't get confused. Arthropod borne, what kind of word? It is mosquito, insect, snail, house fly. So these are the arthropods. Now there are three types of, there are two types of vector borne diseases. How it causes the modes of transmission? Number one is mechanical mode of transmission, and second is biological mode of transmission. Mechanical mode of transmission means, once this vector, keep in mind the house fly, moves here and there. If this housefly sits on the prepared food, or it crawls through the prepared food, so whatever the infectious agents are present on the wings of the housefly or on the legs of the housefly,
it will infect that food. And if that food is infected, food is consumed by the human being, that is called as, it will cause the GI tract disease, diarrhea, dysentery, everything. Just like that. Very simple. So, mechanical mode of transmission means infectious agent is present on the body of the vector, arthropod, housefly, and unknowingly that housefly is moving through the food and causing the infection of the food. And if that food is consumed, it will cause the GI tract diseases. This is called a mechanical mode of transmission. Second is the biological mode of transmission. What is biological? Bios means life. Biology, it is a science which deals with the study of the living thing. So, mechanical and biological. Mechanical, I told you, biological means living things are there. So, here, infectious agent enters into the body of the vector, that is arthropod, mosquito, or housefly. Either it will increase in number or it will undergo the cyclical changes in the life cycle of that infectious agent. So depending upon that, this is classified under three things. Propagative means it propagates. It propagates in number, multiplication. So more, if one infectious agent is there in the body of the vector or the housefly or the mosquito, it propagates in number. More number of these infectious agents are seen. Propagative. Second is cyclopropagative, means it increases in number as well as it goes, they undergoes the cyclical changes from one stage to another stage, 1, 2, 3, 4, life cycle change. Third is cyclodevelopmental, means here no replication occurs, but development of that infectious agent occurs into the body of the susceptible host. So this is all about the vector borne disease. Now, what are the characteristics of vector borne disease? Most important characteristics of the vector borne disease is feeding habit of the arthropod. When it feeds and what it feeds. And during feeding, it may infect the food material which is being prepared. So feeding habit, resting habit, eating habit, then the, for example, whenever this mosquito sits on the prepared food, it continuously vomit on that food and it continuously defecate. This is the feeding and the habit of the mosquito by which that food becomes infected. So this is all about the vector borne. Yes, three, I will discuss tonight.